In the early histories of the Second World War, it was argued that the German invasion of Yugoslavia and Greece resulted in a delay of over a month for the invasion of the Soviet Union. This is still propagated online, with articles stating a 5-week delay, and Quora posts saying that Mussolini's Balkan excursion plus a pro-Allied coup in Yugoslavia were the main reasons why. Scheirer, in his popular Rise and Fall of the Third Reich book from the 1960s, describes Hitler's decision to invade Yugoslavia as the most catastrophic single decision in Hitler's career. I think this warrants the question, but is this really the case? Let's take a look at the downfall of Yugoslavia, see all the evidence, and decide for ourselves. Yugoslavia, as a united state, was generally accepted, but not so the ideology of integral Yugoslavism, which was supposed to merge all the component identities. King Alexander had been assassinated in 1934 by the Internal Macedonian Revolutionary Organization, in cooperation with the Croatian Ustasha. Since King Peter II was 11 years old, another relative, Prince Paul, took over. Reforms were enacted to grant as much independence to the various ethnic states within the wider Yugoslavian state as possible, but the Croatian Ustashas especially were anti-Yugoslavian, demanding a large and independent Croatian state based on blood, similar to how the National Socialists in Germany saw things. The Serbians were equally as anti-Semitic and anti-parliamentarian, and the Yugoslavian communists, the KPJ, were also calling for the dissolution of the international Yugoslavian state, since that wasn't the right kind of internationalism. Thus, nobody really wanted a united Yugoslavia, and the country was destabilized to say the least. Well, the Czechs had been a major supplier of weapons to the Balkan countries, and when the Germans took over the Czech territories after the Munich Agreement, this left the Balkan countries without armament supplies. The West couldn't supply the entire Balkans, and so they had to look to a new source of military supplies, and that meant either Germany or the Soviet Union. This was why many Balkan countries ended up going over to the Germans, because Hitler was initially successful in the late 30s and early 1940s, so they felt that they were joining the winning side, and given how terrible Marxism had been in the Soviet Union, and not able to see into the future, they thought Germany was the lesser of two evils. Yugoslavia initially remained neutral in the war, since it couldn't get military supplies, and Mussolini appeared to be making moves against them, so they had no choice but to make approaches to the Soviet Union for armaments. The fall of France was a huge shock to the world, but especially the Serbs, who mourned the loss, probably knowing that they were in a hopeless situation. The only good news was that Hitler had restrained Mussolini from attacking Yugoslavia, because he feared that this would provoke Stalin. But the pressure was mounting, with Hitler demanding labourers and raw materials be supplied to the Reich, and Yugoslavia was forced to bow to German demands, and even became dependent upon them. The government took emergency measures towards economic mobilisation, which caused a sharp rise in the cost of living in 1940. There were demonstrations against the government and its pro-German economic policy. Unable to attack Yugoslavia, Mussolini attacked Greece instead. And this was a problem because the border with Greece was the Yugoslavian lifeline to the West. The Yugoslav government therefore made an attempt to bring themselves closer to Germany, in a hope that they could persuade Hitler to force Mussolini to back down. The result was that Italy accidentally bombed Yugoslav territory. General Nedić had to resign. Hitler was hoping to get the Yugoslavs on board, but they were reluctant because their population was not happy to join the Germans, since that would render them little more than a puppet state, and would reduce their living standards thanks to the reduction in trade and the German economic demands. Croatians and most Serbs seemed to be united in their opinion that war was to be avoided, at least until the Axis were engaged by the USA or the Soviet Union. Britain was unable to help Yugoslavia and could only suggest that they attack Albania along with the Greeks in order to stop Mussolini, something they obviously weren't willing to do since they were basically surrounded by the Axis.
However, a friendship treaty between Yugoslavia and Hungary was signed in December 1940, which was a major win for the Yugoslavs. Sadly, the Tripartite Pact had been signed by Germany, Italy and Japan in September 1940, and Romania, Hungary and Slovakia had joined it in the November, so it's clear which side Hungary was on. And by February 1941, the Germans had gathered 680,000 men in Romania. The Greeks still resisted the Italians, and Hitler feared that the British would soon be landing troops there after their victory in North Africa during Operation Compass. If the British and Greeks held on in the southern Balkans, not only would this jeopardize Operation Barbarossa, the invasion of the Soviet Union, but it would also allow the British to bomb the Romanian oil fields, something the Germans absolutely could not allow due to the already severe oil crisis that they were suffering under. The Bulgarians believed that Hitler was winning the war, and so allowed German troops into their territory and joined the Axis in early March 1941. But the Yugoslavian government wasn't willing to do this, and started stalling for time. Hitler wanted to resolve the situation in the Balkans prior to Barbarossa, and so demanded that Yugoslavia sign the Tripartite Pact on the 25th of March 1941.
He gave Prince Paul a 5-hour lecture, telling him that there was no alternative. If they didn't sign, there will not remain a single stone in Belgrade. In other words, the Yugoslavs were threatened and bribed with the territory of Salonika into signing the Tripartite Pact. This they reluctantly did on the 25th of March 1941, with some ministers resigning, and Hitler observing that the rest looked as if they were at a funeral.
However, by accepting the leadership of Germany and Italy in the new European order, Prince Paul and his government had ended their policy of neutrality. This was the last straw for the Serb opposition. On the night of the 26th to 27th of March, Yugoslavian Air Force officers, with support by most of the army, overthrew Prince Paul, who was acting regent, and King Peter, age 17, was given the power to rule.
There was some British involvement in this, but as historian Pavlovich says in his Hitler's New Disorder book, probably the best book on this topic, they were merely pushing an open door, since the backlash against Prince Paul's regime was already in full swing.
The new military government, led by General Dušan Simović, offered to sign a non-aggression pact with the Germans, and even said that they still honoured all their international agreements, including the Tripartite Pact, saying the coup was just a domestic issue. But they had effectively broken the puppet status that the Germans had wanted over them. During the delirious celebrations in Belgrade, in which a crowd spat on the German minister's car, the Serbs had shown where their sympathies lay. Interestingly, anti-German demonstrations in Belgrade included an attack on the car of the German minister. I guess spitting is an attack, but in this context it's easy to assume something much worse.
The new government knew they had to play for time and find support. They secretly spoke to the British and even went to the Soviet Union, both of which could only offer moral support.
The coup in Belgrade threw Adolf Hitler into one of the wildest rages of his entire life. He took it as a personal affront, and in his fury made sudden decisions which would prove utterly disastrous to the fortunes of the Third Reich. He hurriedly summoned his military chieftains to the Chancellery in Berlin on March 27th. The meeting was so hastily called that Braukitsch, Halder and Ribbentrop arrived late, and then raged about the revenge he would take on the Yugoslavs.
Pavlovich suggests that Hitler's anti-Serbian bias, which he had had since living in Austria before the First World War, may have contributed significantly to his rage. Beaver also brings this up, saying that he was bent on vengeance against the Serbian population, whom he regarded as responsible for the First World War. And even though it wasn't the case, there's evidence to suggest that Hitler believed that it was a British-led coup, and even a betrayal of the Axis-Soviet Pact. Maybe he thought it was a conspiracy of the Jews or something. After all, he had told Mussolini that the Jews, temporarily out of leadership, would take over the Soviet Union once Stalin died. Hitler said that the attacks on Greece and the Soviet Union were now in danger.
This makes sense when we look at the map. If Yugoslavia becomes allied, or Soviet, it would make it awkward to attack the Soviet Union with such a large allied force behind them. Also, Romanian oil fields would be in range of allied bombers if they could be supplied in Greece or Yugoslavia, so there's no way that Hitler could ignore the Balkan problem anymore. The advantage of taking out Yugoslavia and Greece was that the Croatians would back Germany, giving her a new ally. Plus, Hitler feared that if he attacked the Soviet Union, the entire Balkans and Turkey would be in uproar, since he saw that the Slavs would be united in their struggle against Germany. Taking out Yugoslavia and Greece would eliminate the threat and intimidate the Turks into remaining neutral. So, there were significant benefits to mounting this invasion. Had Hitler not done something like this, then it's possible that the Balkans would have become a major hotspot after the invasion of the Soviet Union, and that could have been even more disastrous than the failure of the campaign would end up being.
Another advantage was that it allowed a trial run for Operation Barbarossa. Behind the lines came the execution squads, targeting the communists and the Jews. In other words, it was a good practice for what was to come later. Hitler categorically rejected any diplomacy. Yugoslavia was to be attacked immediately and destroyed before the new government could declare their loyalty to Germany. Goering was ordered by Hitler to destroy Belgrade by the air, and Keitel and Jodl were ordered to prepare the invasion plans that evening. This would be made easy since they had already had contingency plans drawn up previously in case Yugoslavia didn't join the Tripartite Pact. Plus, Halder had drawn up some rudimentary plans in his car on the way to see Hitler. Ribbentrop was told to tell Italy, Hungary, Romania and Bulgaria that they would all get a slice of Yugoslavia and that a new Croatian puppet state would be formed.
And then, according to an underlined passage in the top secret OKW notes of the meeting, Hitler announced the most fateful decision of all. The beginning of the Barbarossa operation will have to be postponed up to 4 weeks.
The traditional narrative says that Barbarossa had originally been planned to begin on the 15th of May 1941. 4 weeks of delays would move it back to the 15th of June, and in reality it started a week later on the 22nd of June, so we're talking of a 5 week delay.
This postponement in the attack on Russia in order that the Nazi warlord might vent his personal spite against a small Balkan country which had dared to defy him was probably the most catastrophic single decision in Hitler's career. He tossed away his last golden opportunity to win the war, and to make of the Third Reich the greatest empire in German history and himself the master of Europe. Field Marshal von Brauchitsch, the commander-in-chief of the German army, and General Halder, the gifted chief of the General Staff, were to recall it with deep bitterness but also with more understanding of its consequences than they showed at the moment of its making, when later the deep snow and sub-zero temperatures of Russia hit them 3 or 4 weeks short of what they thought they needed for final victory. Forever afterward, they and their fellow generals would blame that hasty, ill-advised decision of a vain and infuriated man for all the disasters that ensued.
It was such a stupid decision that not a single general objected to it at the time, either in public or in private. The gifted Halder doesn't voice any concern in his diary. And how exactly was it ill-advised? Did Hitler receive advice to attack Yugoslavia from his generals? Also, it's no wonder Hitler was angry, since he understood that it would delay the attack on the Soviet Union, supposedly, which Scheirer says was the worst decision of the war. Maybe Hitler understood that this compromised his chances of victory, which was why he was angry. You know, so my point here is that there's holes in the narrative. Did Scheirer consider that the reason Hitler made this decision was because he didn't have a choice? He couldn't attack the Soviet Union, his ultimate goal, if Yugoslavia and Greece were a thorn in his side. So even at face value, this narrative comes apart. It is true that Hitler looked back on this event towards the end of the war and stated that if they had attacked on the 15th of May, they would have won. That's probably where Scheirer is getting this idea from. But as Kershaw points out, the original directive only stated that the preparations for the invasion of the Soviet Union should be completed by the 15th of May, not that the attack should start then. Hitler stated before this point that the attack would probably take place at the end of May, depending on the weather. And the weather was bad in 1941, ruling out an invasion before mid-June. But perhaps the most critical thing to consider is that the invasion of Greece had already been planned months before. There was already a diversion into the Balkans, and this hadn't forced a delay. So if going into the Balkans caused a delay, then why didn't it happen earlier? And the reason why is because Hitler must have assumed that Yugoslavia would be a tougher nut to crack than it ended up being in reality. Spoiler, they didn't last 2 weeks. So Hitler probably issued the delay thinking that this Balkan campaign would take a month to complete, when in fact it was over much quicker than that. Also, if this campaign cost 4 weeks, then why was there an additional week's delay? Was that because of the weather or other factors? Halder says in his diary that Operation Mercury, the invasion of Crete, may have caused a delay because the Luftwaffe units involved would need to be redeployed to East Prussia in time for Barbarossa. But the invasion of Crete would have occurred with or without Yugoslavia, so if there was a delay, it had nothing to do with the coup, and thus the delay would have been issued way before when the planning for the invasion of Greece started. We also have Halder stating in his diary on the 9th of June, "Preparations for 22nd June completed." Now, maybe he didn't mean that they were absolutely ready to go. Maybe it just meant that things were all in motion to be ready for the 22nd. But it could also mean that they were ready to go by the 9th and were just waiting for the good weather. Another argument that some have suggested is that Hitler reduced the amount of troops in Army Group South as a result of the Balkan campaign, which then contributed to the failure. But that decision was made on the 17th of March, way before the coup, so again, this has nothing to do with Yugoslavia. Now, this is not to say that there was no impact on the campaign in the Soviet Union. There was no doubt some wear and tear on the vehicles, a high use of fuel, and perhaps a small delay as the troops were redeployed back to the Soviet border. But overall, the start date for Barbarossa doesn't seem to have been postponed the full 5 weeks because of the Balkan campaign. Maybe a week at most, but nothing like the 5 weeks as argued. So yes, maybe Hitler did blame the failure of Barbarossa on a delay caused by the Balkan campaign, but that doesn't mean it's true. His empire was crashing down upon him when he said that, and instead of blaming himself, he blamed other factors. And notice that the Madman Hitler argument only works one way. When Hitler blames his generals or something we don't like, it's Madman Hitler. But when Hitler blames something that fits the narrative that the historians are in favour of, then we all of a sudden just have to agree with him. Like, all of a sudden we don't think critically about why he might have said that, and then we ignore the evidence and logic that might contradict it. So yeah, to me this Madman Hitler narrative is too simple, I'm not convinced that the Balkan campaign had as severe an impact on Barbarossa as has often been portrayed.
Back on the 27th of March 1941, Jodl worked all night in order to make the plans for the invasion of Yugoslavia. Before they were ready, Hitler sent a message to Mussolini warning him of the impending attack and to prepare his forces immediately.
Suddenly, anti-Yugoslav propaganda was written which claimed that Serbs had targeted ethnic Germans, in much the same way that the Germans claimed that the Poles had done to the Germans in Danzig. This propaganda blamed the Serbs in particular, setting the others against them, and then also said that behind both Yugoslavia and Greece was England.
Thus, without any declaration of war, the invasion began on the 6th of April 1941. The Yugoslavian army was completely outgunned, outmatched, and had no chance. They tried to defend the whole country, stretching their divisions thin across a wide front, which most historians describe as a mistake. This is probably true, but what other possible strategy was there? They were surrounded on all fronts, so it's doubtful that any other tactic would have worked. Reservists, called up last minute, hadn't yet reached their units, and so chaos ensued when the attack went in. When the attack occurred, troops were crisscrossing the country. Mobile forces, motor transport, tanks, anti-tank and anti-aircraft artillery were in short supply. The Air Force had but few modern planes. In other words, there wasn't a hope for the regular army. It is true that the Axis attacked from Hungary, Romania and Bulgaria, but initially it was all German troops. Italian troops did move down the coast though, and at the same time as attacking the Yugoslavs, the Germans struck into Greece from Bulgaria with List's 12th Army. Despite being declared an open city, Belgrade was smashed by the Luftwaffe over 3 days in Operation Punishment. The city had no anti-aircraft guns and was completely at the mercy of the German bombers. Almost 50% of the housing was destroyed, and estimates of the casualties range from 1,500 to 30,000 dead, with many more wounded. Beaver says it was probably in the middle, and Shira says 17,000 dead, so it's probably best just to go with that. Surprisingly, the Yugoslav army conducted an offensive into Albania, partly to support the Greeks, but also to widen the gap that their forces could retreat through. Part of their overall plan was to fall back to the south. Unfortunately, the attack was stalled after Italian intelligence disrupted it through the use of fake orders, and the retreat to the south didn't happen because the army basically disintegrated or was overrun. The Germans noted that Serbian units resisted with rather more determination than Croats or Macedonians, who often surrendered at the first opportunity. This makes sense given that the Croatians and Macedonians were wanting emancipation. They didn't actually want to fight for Yugoslavia. The government fled from the capital on the first day, Zagreb fell on the 10th, and Croatia declared its independence. The army ordered every unit to act on their own initiative, which they did by falling back constantly. Hungary joined in the invasion on the 11th, and Belgrade fell to the Germans and Hungarians on the 13th of April, and the remains of the Yugoslavian army, still 28 divisions strong, surrendered at Sarajevo on the 17th. This was just 12 days after the war had begun. Three divisions in the south just sent their men home with their weapons and didn't even bother to surrender. That same day, the Italians reached the Bay of Kotor and captured the Yugoslavian navy. There were perhaps 344,000 Yugoslav prisoners of war, the numbers are disputed, plus many more soldiers and civilians killed. The Germans had suffered 558 casualties in Yugoslavia, of which just 151 were killed. The Italians lost 3,500. However, a good chunk of those captured were released back home, with only 191,000 remaining prisoners. These were mostly Serbs, whom the Germans blamed for the war. In fact, only 10 German divisions were engaged in combat for more than 6 days throughout the entire Balkan campaign, including Greece, where another 100 men were killed and 3,500 wounded or missing on the German side. King Peter and his prime minister escaped by plane to Greece, and a few days later on the 23rd, the Greek army in the north surrendered, and Greece was equally overwhelmed by the Axis onslaught. Mussolini's drive into Greece had been thwarted, and Hitler had saved him, which was good. But he was humiliated that he'd had to rely on German help, since fascist Italy had been too weak to do the task alone. This wasn't helped by the fact that Rommel had been sent to North Africa and was bailing out the Italians there as well. In late March, Rommel's first offensive had started, and within 12 days he had recaptured all of Libya that had been lost by the Italians except Tobruk. If you want to see Rommel achieve this victory, I've got a video
on that right here. So yes, let me know what you guys think. Was Barbarossa delayed by the Yugoslavian campaign? Did I miss anything out? Comment below. Thanks for watching. Bye for now.